Hello, coders. Good morning, everybody. Hope everybody's well. Hope everybody is doing well. Sorry. Murphy's around. I've literally just taken him out for a walk. If you see any water splatter on my face, I think I've got it all off. But it's raining out there. It's raining outside. It's cold. It's like the rain that is almost snow, if that makes sense. Today we're going to be dealing with, yeah, good morning, Tyranid. The Murphy is about. So if you hear any squeaks, if you hear any sort of not barking, but sort of low gruffs, then it's the dog. It isn't me. Today we're going to be dealing with some codeception. We're going to be dealing with some APIs. Primarily, we're going to be focusing on the JSON API schema. The specification of JSON API. And we just to give you some context, this is part of the How to Code Well API stuff that we're doing. So it's still in that same sort of vein. I will just throw up the JSON API schema. JSON API schema. JSON specification. I keep calling it schema. It's specification. Okay, bring it up here. And let's go into this mode. There we go. Woohoo! So this is the JSON API specification for building APIs in JSON. Now, let's see if I can make that a little bit bigger. Unfortunately, all of the APIs that I've dealt with in my freelance career, I should say, haven't used the JSON API. So this is extremely new to me. And the reason why I want to use this specification is it describes how the JSON payload, how the JSON response, how it should be structured, right? It's a specification for that. And because I've got so many APIs at the moment, it would be nice to have a commonality between all of them. This is the structure of a typical blog post. Now, on first look, this might seem like a huge amount of noise, but actually it makes, in my opinion, quite a lot of sense. So it's explaining the way in which this API behaves and works with other APIs. So for instance, or API endpoints. So here we have a set of links. So we have self, next, and last. Bearing in mind that this is about a blog, so this is pagination, next and last. This is the current endpoint that you're on. Then we have a list of data. We have the type, which is articles, its ID, a series of attributes about the particular article, and then the relationship of that article with, say, authors, comments, their links, a little bit of data about them, and then included data, so included bits and pieces about the people, so first name, last name. We've dealt with the JSON API a little bit with the course API that I am being building. The thing is, though, I was using, and I'm going to get this completely wrong, so I'm going to just double check. I was using a Symfony bundle, which is, where can I find that? In the composer.json, of course. So we were using this bundle here, which is fantastic. However, the more I was using it, the more I found that it wasn't actually doing, or it was doing too much. I mean, it's a lovely bundle, the JSON API bundle. And essentially what was happening was that you could create your SRC controller. Let's pick one from random. So you've got a resource collection. You set the repository to that resource collection. You then handle the index requests. And I was trying to do all sorts of things. That didn't work. I was trying to do all sorts of things to filter the query, and I was getting nowhere. This one here is, so this is returning an API response based on the document and transformer. It was working fine, apart from the fact that I wanted to, when I got to the point where I wanted to actually put in my own queries and actually hack about with the response, I couldn't really do that very easily. Not in a sort of a framework agnostic kind of manner anyway. We have things like your the resource collections. You also have your it's not there, is it? It's in here. Your documents. So you've got your course document, courses document. Murphy's chewing. He's got a tennis ball in the room and he's chewing it. He's sort of knocking the microphone stand as he's doing so. And then you've got hydrators and then you've got transformers. So there's quite a lot involved in all of this stuff. It had a really nice way of generating all of this on the fly, which is great. The problem though was querying. I couldn't easily put in a query to say, you know, only find active users or only do this if you're a particular have a particular user role. Because what I would like to do eventually is I would like to have this to be the same. I would like to have a similar set of API calls for, say, a super user, then a normal user, and then knowing the token that is returned, knowing that a particular user has more roles than another user, I would be able to put in more bits and pieces into the query, and also return more fields in here. So for example, if I was an admin user and this was returning a user, then I could put in, say, their activation state, their last logged in state date, that those kind of things. However, I probably don't want to have all of that when I'm actually as a single user. Also, I want to have more flexibility and control over the filters. So with JSON API, what you do is you create like a query string, and it traverses the fields and it filters on that. It's not very brilliant for caching. So I kind of want to have more control over that as well. So that being said, in the user API, I'm using another way of creating the JSON API specification, and that is using this bundle here. And so far, I mean, I've only played with it yesterday, last night and the night before. We're using, where are we? Not Codeception. Composer, this bundle here, it is the this one, NemoRockX JSON API. It's a framework agnostic API, package. So what we do here in the user controller is I ran a test. So is admin checking whether you're an admin user, and then you've got an encoder. And what you do is you encode the user, and it returns an array that you can then JSON decode, put it into a JSON response. So the encoder deals with how this JSON, the JSON data is actually going to be encoded. And like I said, I've only played with it for a few hours. So Murphy, can you, thank you. So I've only played with it for a few hours, but essentially what you've got is a series of fields here. So I've got admin fields and I've got public fields. And what I've done is I've sort of hacked it together and I've merged them, depending on whether you are an admin or not. And then you encode it using an encoder instance, and it's a user class. These are schemas. So you're matching up the entities or whatever it is, because it's agnostic. Whatever class you want to match to a schema. Now, I found, unfortunately, with Doctrine, it's not unfortunate, it's just the way it works, isn't it? Doctrine uses proxies, so this is my sort of hacky way of setting a profile proxy to a profile schema. And then what you do is you return the encoder, you set some options, the URL prefix, the included paths, the fields that you want to return, and then the actual, the thing that you want to try and encode. The schemas are pretty cool because here you can define the actual attributes that you're returning, their relationships and how they work. It's pretty cool. And of course, there's one for the user, and so far I think I've got one for the profile as well. So if I loaded that up, profile schema, yeah. So you got the Patreon is subscribed. So far it's working okay. What I would like to do today, I've only got it running on that one API here, that one endpoint. What I would like to do is use this for the other endpoints as well that we have here. And I want to use Codeception as a way of testing. As I said at the start of this, I want to have a common way, a common sort of pattern of response, right? That I want to check. Now, something that I did off stream is I used Codeception and I created API tests. Sorry if you're hearing any noise, it's Murphy. And so these are set in, not there, it's set in tests, API suite. Okay, so this is the configuration for the Codeception. So we can set the REST details. I'm also configuring it with a database as well, which means that I can actually run APIs and manipulate the data. And each time what it's going to do is it's going to clean up the data based on this dump.sql, which is in data dump.sql, this thing. So every test is going to run this. It's basically just a dump that I've used. It will clean the database up and it will run this, right? So we've got cleanup is true, populate is true, running off of this, which means that these tests are slow, but they are simulating a real world request. And with the tests themselves, if I go into here, click on to the user test, here we go. So what we're doing here is we're saying, I want to be bearer authenticated. Now I'll talk about that in just a second because that's a whole different kettle fish. And then we want to do a send request to this endpoint. We want to make sure that it's got the HTTP okay. And then here we can see that the JSON matches this type, and we can say that, you know, we must have data must have a type, that must be a string, has an ID, that must be a string. This becomes our little sort of pattern match, if you will. So it's not actually checking the data that comes back, as in the values, it's checking how the data is structured and the actual data types. Murphy just keeps putting his tennis ball down and just staring at it as though it's going to jump out and get him. I'm waiting for him to settle down, and what he'll do is he'll skin it alive, the tennis ball. Sorry about that. I've had to remove on there, I'm pointing at the wall, on the wall here, there was some PHP elephants, PHP sort of mascots. He's had them. He's had them, unfortunately. They're fine. One of them's missing an eye. Okay, so let me show you one of these requests going through, right? So okay, I tell you what, before I do that, let me talk to you about this. I want to be bearer authenticated. So with Codeception, you can create helpers. And where are we? API, no. No, certainly not that. I've totally lost it. Where is it? Data? No. Output? No. Support. There we go. So you pass in your API tester, and in here there is, I think in here there is, yes, in helper, you can create your own sort of methods that you can call upon during your tests. So here I want to be bearer authenticated. Again, we're passing in a Boolean here is true, so we're setting that as false by default. And what we're doing is we're setting the tokens, we're setting them up like that. So if is admin, then we get the admin token, or if we're not, then we get the public token. Public token is it's not public, as in you need to log in, but it's not the admin token, if that makes sense. So, okay, this simulates an admin login. This simulates a public login, and this is the login. So we go send a REST request to this post, to this endpoint here. We're going to JSON encode the data, and then we're going to JSON decode the response, and we're going to get the token. And then what we're going to do is we're going to return the token back to these things, and then that's going to set this public and this or this admin token. So that's how we simulate an actual login, which means that on the user tests itself, why do I keep clicking that? Here, we can do I want to be bearer authenticated, and that means that we're going to set the token, which means that the next request has that token in its header, which is pretty awesome. It's sort of a bit of magic going on there. And I could put true and false in there depending on what type of user I want. Okay, so that's that. I've also set up something that I haven't been able to do in the freelance world, just because there was no projects used it, unfortunately. But I have known about it because I've seen a talk on it, and I've wanted to do it for a long time. And that is in Postman here, when we do a login, there is this. How awesome is this? So you can write JavaScript in Postman in the tests, and what we're doing here is we're setting we're parsing the response of this admin login, and we're pulling out the token, and we're setting that as an environment variable called admin token, which means that it's so cool, this, which means that in subsequent API calls, we can pull out the environment variables. So if I go over to here and here, can you see all these environment variables? So I could delete one of these. I could delete this, for instance, and log in, and it'll be repopulated. So let's do that. Let's delete that. And we'll delete that too. Right, so that's completely empty. The admin token is totally empty. Okay. Cancel update. There we go. Oh, no, I don't want to do that. And then let's log in. So let's come away from that, go into body. So that's what we're sending, the username and password of the admin user. Again, environment variables. I'm going to send the request. That's the token that we get back. That's the JWT. But check this out. If I go to dev, it's been set. It's been set. That's awesome. That's so cool. Which means that the next set of API calls, I can use this token in the bearer, in the authentication. And wonderfully, with Postman, something that I think you could only do in the later versions is that you can do right click on here, or click on the three little thingies, click on edit, and then you can do authorization, and you can set the admin token straight away like this, and it's a bearer token. And you can do that on this folder, which means that all of these have that, which is so cool. So that's how I'm doing Postman tests is, so I've just logged in, and then if I did send, there we go. So this is the actual API that I was showing you. So here we've got username, email, and active. And this is based on the admin user. Let's say I wanted to do this though on the public user. So let's say I wanted to log in, because what I want to do, sorry, if I go back here, is I don't want to have the active flag on the public user. I only want that when you're in admin. Think of it like you've got the same API request that you're calling, but one's from a content management system and one's from the front end. So on this case, what I can do on the public sense, if I hit send, so this is now logging in as the public user. And what's happening here, so that's a different token, because that's the public token, is in, where are we? I want to find that user controller again. Controller. So what it's doing now is it's saying, well, you'll know that's now false because I don't have that role. So I'm going to pass in false in here, which means that when I go to the encoder, we're not going to get the admin fields. We're only going to get the public fields. Okay. So we don't have active, or we shouldn't have. I did this last night, very late last night. So let's just see if this works. So if we go over to here and then hit send, we shouldn't have the active field. doing this on live. There we go. We don't. Phew. So that's cool. I'm happy with that. So it's only getting the public fields. Awesome. Okay. Wonderful. So what I would like to do now is I would like to, as I mentioned, I want to fill out the other APIs using this encoder, which I think is pretty good for what I need. I want to run some tests. I want to make sure that they're tested, and I want to create a common sort of pattern, because if we go back to here, you can see that there is a commonality. There was a link somewhere I saw. Check out the document for base specification. Here we go. So a document must contain at least one of the following top level members: data, errors, or meta. At least one of, okay? And then a document may contain any of the top level members, so JSON API links and included. So we've got some rules to play with. I like rules. It keeps me on the straight and narrow. So this is the structure. For example, the following primary data is a single resource object. So we have data, type, ID, attributes, and relationships. This becomes our sort of pattern that we want to match. So what I would like to do, much like I've done with the... The bearer token jobby, which is in API. I want to be bearer authenticated, and I can't do that because it's using the magic stuff. So if we go to support helpers API, I want to have a similar method where I can check. So basically something like, I want to be JSON API specification compliant, something like that. And I can throw it against all the other tests. Let's run all these tests, actually. Let's do that first. Make sure that we've got some stable ground to work on. So let's jump into the Docker containers. I need to go into the actual thing. Docker compose, .exec, go into there. Okay, and then we do bin... Do I have CodeSept? CodeSept, yep. And then it is run. Can you remember last time, like a few streams ago, we only had four tests? Well, I've got a couple more now. We've got 10 API tests. Now, these API tests are going to, they're going to drop the database and repopulate the database on each one. So these are going to take a long time. I don't expect to run these every time I make a change. However, I will be running these during every deployment. So we'll wait for all those to go.
Murphy, what's this?
Oh, he's dropped his tennis ball under the table. Bear with me a minute. Okay, so these are going through all the tests. There's quite a few. Well, there's only 10, but it's going to take some time because it is going through the database. It's dropping the database and then it's repopulating it. for each one. This is what I've been doing in my evenings. So here we're testing a login, there we're testing registration. Then this is getting that user. Here we're testing that there, you know, I can do various things in admin mode and I can do various things in public mode. You wouldn't have guessed that I've taken him out for a walk already. He's and yesterday we had a really long walk.
We did, didn't we?
Got up super early yesterday and took the boy out for a nice run. Okay, well, we didn't run, but we were throwing the ball around a field that had nobody there, which was brilliant. So, okay, we now have 21 tests, 43 assertions. They all passed, so that's our stable relay. Wee! Squeaky toy. That's all of our... I best say to everybody who's watching who doesn't know, it's Murphy. He's his puppy. English Springer Spaniel. Give me a second. There we go. thank you, Murphy. Thank you for that. So, good boy. You good boy. Okay, so, what we're going to do is we're going to create a new method in here. What should I call it? This method is going to check the JSON specification, the sort of the top level stuff. And it's usually starts with want. So I want, so it's like I, because that's the variable name, want to be, because that's following on to here, I want to be. I want to have JSON API. Well, I have JSON API spec. I have JSON API spec. Or I meet JSON API spec. That's fine. okay, so how do I get... So if I did this, then we do. Awesome. We do have all that. Awesome. I thought we didn't have I, but we do. This obviously extends module. There we go. So in the... Bless him, he's just curled up now. Curled up, but still clutching his tennis ball. He didn't like that, by the way, when I picked him up, because the tennis ball was on the floor. And he was in the air. Murphy, are we going to tell them about your tennis ball? So it's not his tennis ball. He found it. He commandeered the tennis ball on his walk. And he's been so happy about taking someone else's tennis ball. So we found the tennis ball as we came out of the house, as we came out of the drive. It was just on the pavement. Someone else's tennis ball. Some poor dog didn't bring their tennis ball home. And Murphy's got it. And he's the happiest he's ever been. Okay, so want to have JSON API. API spec. So in here, we can basically take this essentially, and put that into here, but what I want to do is obviously make this a little bit more common. Do I have C? No, I don't. Oh, this might be an issue. Maybe I can't do that. Anyway, I want to make sure that this is an array. I'm probably going to get a bunch of bugs when I do this, so just bear with me as I go through it. We want to make sure that there is an array of relationships. And we want to make sure that there is an array of links as well. Included, it doesn't have to, you don't have to have included, I don't think, if we read the specification. So if I go up here, the document may contain any of these. So links, included, and API. So it doesn't need to have links either, but it has to have, a document may. So what it does need, sorry, it must have data errors. It must have data or errors or meta. Okay. So included and isn't. Let's just take that out for a minute. I think I'm going to get some errors anyway, because this method isn't in the module. So I've got to sort of work that through.
Squeaky squeak.
I wonder if it's based on the rest. So this get module I am. I wonder if that's the way to do it. Thank you for your input, Murphy. Thank you. I agree. Wholeheartedly, I agree. So, can I do C? No, I can't. Can I do... I'm just going up here just to see how that is handled. I am. So that's am. So if we did... Settle down. Same. Let's just try it and see. Oh, sorry, that clipped a bit. Let's just see if this breaks, which I'm sure it does. What we'll do is we'll replace this with that method. So we'll just comment that out for a minute, and then we can do I want to have JSON API spec. Okay, and have I called this secure get user? Okay, so we'll do on here, we'll run the only this API, G is the group, and it is get hyphen user. Okay, so it's going to run that specific test. And it's failed. Okay. So it's failed because call to undefined method, you see, can't find it. So we're in the helper, which is good, but we can't do that. Call to undefined method. Okay, let's just run it again a minute. Thing with Codeception is you have to sort of make it build these helper methods. so they don't always work on the first instance. Nope. Wishful thinking there. Wishful thinking. Is it the same error? Yeah. Okay, so I have JSON API spec is going into here, and it is this C matches JSON type. Now, what did I do the other day which allowed me to do this from a unit test? Because I was testing, I was building a unit test, and I was testing an API. I was testing JSON. Let me have a think. Was it in entity utils JSON handler? JSON handler. So a new new JSON handler, and then we decode that request. Is array. What's JSON handler? JSON handler decodes. Okay, no, that's not it, is it? Nope. Would it be in one of these? It might not even be in this API. No, bear with me then. I'll have a look. There's something I'm sure I've done which instantiates that low-level class. And I'm sure I've done it as a unit test. Is it message bus? There we go, new JSON type. And then we can see this type matches. So we might be able to get away with that. So it's JSON type. Okay, I'm going to flick forward and back through these projects a minute just to... we don't need that. Okay, just to check stuff. Sorry. So... Oh, man. Sorry. JSON. So type is equal to new JSON type. I had it there, JSON type. Okay, so that's after that's instantiated, what else do you do? JSON type. Okay, so you pass in the data that you want to check. Ah, that might be troublesome because the data in the test is already known. Oh. Maybe there's a better way of doing this. How else could I do this? I could extend this to something else that has I. Because that's what I need. I want I. I don't have I unless I pass in I. Ooh, I could do that. I could pass in I, couldn't I? I could pass I in. I, by the way, has all of these methods that I need. That's essentially what I need. So I could pass in I. I don't know if this is bad practice or not. So passing in I into this API helper. So that becomes I. And then get rid of that. Then this becomes I. All right, let's see, because I has knowledge of the actual request. Come on. Yeah, he's got one paw on a squeaky toy, whilst chewing the tennis ball. Oh, it worked, didn't it? Hey. Sweet. Squeaky, squeak, squeak, squeak. He was squeaking in celebration. Okay. So that, yeah, so that now works, which means now that I can put this, I can make sure that there are specific things in here for that specific API request, but this is just making sure that it's adhering to that specification. The things that are specific to this request would be obviously the attributes. So let me uncomment this for a minute. And we don't need that because that's already checked. We do need the attributes and the names. We do need the relationship, the profile. We don't need the links, but we do need data type and ID. Again, we don't need that. We do need the included bits. Attributes, Patreon. Yep, cool. Okay, let's run that again.
Hello.
Cool. Okay, that worked. Okay, let's move on to another API, shall we? Because that looks good. I'm going to move on to... So down here. So that's running off of forward slash. So that's getting the current user based on the token that was supplied. It's all handled in this get user call, by the way. We start from the top. So this is API user, users API user, which will get all of the users. Which can only be ran by the admin. And this doesn't follow the JSON specification at all. Not one bit. However, this requires pagination, and I'm not in a place yet where I can actually put pagination in. So let's scroll down a little bit more. We've just done this one. This one I want to play with. This is /username. So this is passing in the username to get a single user. Again, this is only required for, can only be done by the admin user. So what I'm doing at the moment is I'm kind of thinking of what I would like in a CMS, what kind of admin calls I would need. Okay, so the first thing we can do is on, this is user by username. We can have a look at the test for that backs this up. We know that this is in the wrong format, so we can do get user admin. Here we go. Scroll. Do I have anything in here? So that's getting all the users. This is checking for different types of authentication. There must be. That's by ID. Maybe I haven't tested it. Oh dear. Okay, well. So that's by the token. That's what we've just done. Login, register, user. No, I don't think we have. Oh, well, let's go and add one. So this is by ID. I'm going to copy this and do this by... username. However, I'm just going to double check something in the controller. Username, because that's a string, and then ID is there we go. It's checking the ID. Okay. Why don't we do the ID first? Because I know that we already have tests to back that one up. So let's do that. So that would be this one here. Okay, so this is trying to do this API call whilst as a public user. This will return a forbidden error code. This will do it. Users no auth public test. So this is again when you don't even have a token. So this is, I want to be authenticated but publicly. And then you're trying to run an admin API endpoint, and that returns forbidden. This one here is, I don't even have a token, but I want to try and do this anyway, and this will be unauthorized. Awesome. So we don't have to worry about those two too much. It's this one. So I want to be bearer authenticated true. So this is where I have the admin token, and I want to pull this out. Again, because I'm using the dumping the database, I know that this test account is there. Okay, so I can see that the test is running HTTP okay, which is good. But I also want to do this. I want to have a JSON API spec. Want to have JSON API spec. Now, I know that this is going to fail because we've just done this. We've changed the... the response. Sorry, I'm going all over the place. Where is my controller? Here. Wahoo. So here, right. So this is by ID. This is the response that's coming back at the moment. What I want is to have that JSON API specification. So this will fail. This is based on, if I go back to this one here. So this is get users by admin. Let me just make sure that is... Yeah, cool. That's the one here. So we're going to run this. This should fail. It will complain that the response is not the right response. I hope.
You're right, Murphy.
You're right. Good boy. Yeah. Okay, why is it doing two tests? Why is it doing two? And why did one pass? Admin get users. I might be using that by admin. Let's do user ID. Let's just create that as a... I only want to focus on this specific test. I don't want to be messing around with anything else. But yes, this error is, this error needs to, I need to pass in I, don't I?
Oh, silly me.
Sorry, let me cancel that and run it again.
Good boy,
Murphy. Yeah. Okay, so here we're saying that this is the response that we want to match, but we didn't get it. We got this instead. So let's see if I can hack this up. Let's see if I can not hack this up. Let's see if I can change this response to sort of mimic this encoder. All right. Scroll. That's by username. This is by ID. And as I do this, I'm starting to think that there's going to be some common code. So there is going to be a need for refactoring. Let me see. How do I put that as data? Do I need to encode it or decode it? Yeah. So where is this? Here. JSON decode the data as an array. I believe that's a stream, I think. Okay, so use the encoder. So I already know that I'm admin, so I don't need to do that, but I need to pass in true. Because I have that role. Okay. So let's see if we can run this test. Hopefully now it will come back. So it has. So it has. Let's run this against a Postman request. So this is the it's the get user by ID. Here we go. So let's send that. It might say that the token is expired, and if that's the case, we'll just do a refresh. We'll do a re-login. There we go. It knows that it's admin, so it has the active. So yeah, awesome. Good stuff. Good stuff. Now this and this is the same, isn't it? So could really do with putting that in a function, in a single function. Somewhere. I need to think about this. It could go in a service, couldn't it? With the option of... So, if I was to do this, let me just create some pseudo code here. So, if we did public function... Public function temp. Just to, I will sort this out soon. And then we pass in, it is the user, so that's a user entity. We have the isAdmin flag, which is set to false. And what it's doing, well actually I know that I am an admin user because I can, the trick though is that yeah, let's do is admin. Okay, so that's fine. That's the user. That is the JSON response. This then is the little helper method. That's a little helper method. What shall I call this? Get, or it's JSON. It's a JSON response, but it's a JSON response of a user. So user JSON response. User JSON response. I think I'm going to need to have somewhere, probably in a folder called JSON response, different types of responses. JSON so this one is going to be user JSON response. Let's just grab one of those. It's kind of a habit I do that. I just grab something and then just change it and update this to be... I need like a shortcut key that just builds the namespace in the class. I know that you can do it in PHP Storm. So this is user JSON response. And what this is going to do is it's... Sorry, Murphy, sorry. I didn't know that's where you put your ear. I know. They're looking up to me like I've just stepped on his ear. Sorry, buddy. Oh. He's lying on my feet. Okay. So what I want to do here is... I want to take the, where did I put it? This. And I want to put it in there. And I want to have this as, do I do build? Make. Okay. Cool. Okay. And that has the encode. Maybe it should be called encode user response. Encode user JSON response. I can change it later, can't I? But the idea is that I want to now do a return. Well, I need to push it in, don't I? I need to. JSON response. Make sure that's in the right. JSON response. Make sure it's in the right namespace. Because in here we do user. JSON response as response, and then here we do a return of response make, passing in the user and the is admin, which I can do as that check in here. Okay. All right, which means that I can change this one to be the same. So we need to have user JSON response as response. It's a bit weird that I'm putting in the response. That doesn't sit right with me. I'm putting in the response. I think it shouldn't be called a response. I think this should be called. We have an encoder. Maybe it is user encoded response. Yeah, maybe it's that. Oh, I don't want to call it response. User encoded? Naming things is difficult in programming. User encoded. So you got the user encoder and the user encoded. Maybe I need to put this then maybe I need to put this then in here. So we got user encoder and user encoded. And then this could be get response. Or get JSON response. JSON response. Okay. And I think I'm going to change that to be encode rather than encoder. So that encodes this is the encoded. it's again, that doesn't sit right, but it's better than it was. And then in here, we have user encoded and we're passing in, so this is encoded. Or encode, it's actually an encoder. It's actually an encoder, isn't it? Really, because the encoder is actually performing the action to encode. Yeah. I wonder if this is what we need to do. If that, instead of that being called the user encoder, why don't we change this to be... Naming things in programming is very, very tricky. So, it is the encoder. It is the user encoder. So I'm going to change this to be just encoder. I think that there's going to be more than one, right? And if they are just literally like this, we could just have a series of methods. So that should be okay. So we're going to change this to be encoder. No, we are going to put that back to user encoder. So that's user encoder. Just skip that one a minute. And that will have an interface of get response, of get JSON response. So there's going to be more than one, which means that this needs to be renamed to user encode. Yeah, user encode. And then this is user encoder. Processor. Now we're getting fancy with our names. User encoder is going to encode and return the JSON response. It's going to take the user encode processor and it's going to process this. So we're going to do process that is going to be renamed to processor. Or process. Cool. So we get the processor, we process the user, and then we return that back. Excellent. Okay, that makes sense, more sense in my head, I think. Good. Okay, so let's go and fix everything that I've broken. So that's the encoder processor. No, that's not right. This is the user user encoder. Encoder get JSON response, and we're going to put in the user. That's what the thing that we want to encode, and the options on how we want to encode it. That makes more sense in my head. So let's tidy up. We won't do that yet. This is the getting of the user. So that's user encoder. Wonderful. Cool. I think that's good. Let me run the tests again. I'll run all of them. Hopefully, it should be fine. Looking good so far. I've woken up this morning really hungry, like super hungry. I don't know what it is. Like, as soon as I wake up these days, I just want to eat a Sunday roast. I had a terrifying nightmare the other day. Spooky, spooky, spooky nightmare. Nuts. I shudders every time I think about it. It was crazy. Yeah. I don't often dream, or I don't often remember my dreams, but that was nuts. And nothing to do with work either. Which is when I dream, I usually dream of work, if that. Which isn't healthy, I don't think. Okay, come on, go through all the things. It's looking good so far. Woohoo! I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab a cup of tea, because my tea is now very cold, and then I'll be back for the next bit of the stream, and we'll work through the other APIs and the other tests. So I will be back very, very shortly. Okay. Sorry. Ah. Ooh, I just let him out. Just noticed I'm sort of halfway off the screen here. This great thing with this microphone, I can pick it up. Move it. Okie dokie. Murphy, calm down, mate. Come on. Good boy. Yeah. Good boy. Okay. So those tests have passed. That's all good. So we can move on.
Good boy.
We could do the same for the username. So this is getting the user by the username. Although that's doing it by the ID. I'm getting confused here. That's not what this does. Username. Manager, find user. User manager interface. That doesn't seem right to me. Another thing that we could do is simulate the errors as well. That's something that we need to do, isn't it? So this one here. Let's just get the okay responses working first, and then I'll go through the errors. So this doesn't... I'm confused here. This doesn't really make much sense. I'm going to do an API recall just to this directly and see if I can get this to run. So get users by username. So that is the username of a user. We're going to hit send. This is probably going to error because of the JWT is expired. Yeah. Oh, no. So that's the error that happens. If we go and have a look at the... I didn't anticipate that. Let's go to Docker, compose bash, and let's tail... You're right. Tail f var... is it logs? And then is it devlog or is it log and then dev? I forget. It's that one. Okay, so the error here is... And I can't really see it very well. Let me... I tell you what, let's do all this horizontally. Let's get rid of that and go into here. Oh, that wasn't clever. That wasn't the most clever thing I've done today. Silly me, sorry. Right, let's do this again. I've just come out of the whole thing. All right. And then, so that's the bash. That's the logs. Okay. Cool. And this is going to be the test. So we'll do bin code. I won't run the tests again, but we'll just have it code set run API. Okay, so the error on that previous thing was this. So uncaught exception, not found, no root found for blah, 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 blah. So it can't find that. I'm just seeing if anything precedes it. Ooh, that needs to go. All user... So that's getting the current user of the current token. And then here is get user name, which is what we're looking at. And then down here, we have get user by ID based on the regex. By ID. And the name here is the root name. Is user single by ID, and then this is just single by username. Okay, so / username, API user, and then the username. And then here we have by ID, and that is API user and then the ID. API user and then the username. And this is saying that it can't find that path. No route found for API username. I'm of the opinion that I don't actually need this because I've got the ID, but I just want to work my way through this. So let's hit that again. It's taking a while, isn't it? Oh, I've got an expired JWT. I need to log in again. And then we can do this by username. I mean, even that needs to be formatted, that expiry. Okay, select. So this now seems to be coming through. User not found. Interesting. Interesting. So this is the query. Select username. Where TID. Oh, that's running off of the ID. So the user manager here. Let's see if I can get another one called find user by username. And that will be the username. And user manager. Well, actually, yeah, I don't need to do that, do I? Because there's already a declaration in, because this is extending the base manager. So I should be able to, hopefully, where we've got find user, we should be able to do find. Yeah, here we are, user by username. Okay, let's see if we can run that post request. It was a get request. Oh, I keep saying, oh, it's my puppy. There we go, we got the user now. Okay, I just want to try and do this by the ID, okay? Essentially, both requests should come with the same thing. But I'm dubious as to why this is working and why that's not working. Because it was working before. User not found. Is this running off of this request? Let's just do test spelt badly. I think it is. And I think it is because I think that this needs to go after the regex, because I think in order of in order of routes, this is being checked last. So it will always go, oh, it's a string, it's a username, okay, we'll do it. So yeah, I think this needs to go below the ID request. Because what it'll do is it'll look for this based on these requirements, which is the UUID requirements. It won't do anything because it doesn't match the UUID. And then it'll go, okay, we'll get it by the username instead. User not found. I'm going to do by username just to get some clarity. And then up here, we're going to do user not found by ID. All right. So this is running off of the ID, the UUID. Come on. There we go. So that's getting it by that ID. And then here we do it by the username. So let's see if we can get this to run. Which it is. Sweet. Okay, so that's sorted. Let's now return. Let's do the encoder again to get the response. And we need to put in user encoder, don't we? Starting to think that the user encoder should actually just be injected into the constructor. And this could be get single response, or get single JSON response, and then you could have get paginated JSON response. All right. Okay, let's see if that returns. Yum. Tea. Do like tea. Come on. I know you are in dev mode and I know you have to redo all the caching and everything, but really, come on. There we go. Okay. Cool. We do need to update that test as well, whilst I remember. Actually, no, we don't have a test for it, do we? We need to write a test for it. That's what we need to do. So we need to go to API. So this is get user by ID. We're going to do the same, but get user by username. So we, first of all, we'll try and do it publicly. Let's just put in the username here. So that should be forbidden. I mean, these tests are always very, very good to have, just to give you a little bit of confidence, just to make sure that your security is in play. Okay, and then here is the I want to have JSON spec. We'll change the this is get users. It's insecure. Okay, it's this one down here. I want to change username. Okay. Right, let's run all the tests again. Ooh, hello. What's all this? Cannot declare. Oh, I've got, because I've gone and declared this class. There we go. And whilst this goes off, because this is going to take a while, I want to talk a little bit, if I may, about how I want to actually get this deployed and tested. So one of my thoughts, my crazy ideas, is to get a Jenkins box where it listens for commits to a specific branch. At the moment, I've been very sort of loose with my commits. But once it gets into production, I'm hoping that I'll be a little bit more strict upon myself. You know, I haven't done a single commit today, and I've done an awful lot of change, which is not good. Not good. And I want to be very strict with, you know, having tests to cover things. And I don't care if the test takes a long time.
No coders.
Squishing them down is a good idea. Not my bug. I like that. Thank you, Not My Bug, for that suggestion. Squishing them. And thank you, hello. Thank you. Thank you, Not My Bug, for following. Hello. Hello, hello, hello. So yeah, I'm thinking of running this on a Jenkins box. Now, whether Jenkins is going to be in this office or whether it's going to be on the internet, on the cloud, I don't know yet. I don't know yet. But what I would like is some way of automating these tests, definitely. And you know, this is just the user API. We've got several. Let me show you. If let's bring up another tab window. Docker ps-a. So these are the containers that we have. Some of them are down. Oh yeah. Yeah, these were the stuff I was playing with the other evening. So yeah, we've got an enormous amount of containers. Let's see if I can bring that down. Oh no, that's not good, is it? We've got the course API, we've got the user API, we've got Q API, we've got RabbitMQ, we've got the user database, we've got the gateway, we've got the resource API, we've got the resource database and the API itself, and the course database, and there's going to be so much more. So there's an awful lot of stuff, moving parts, in this project. It's not just what I'm showing you here. And it's going to be very fragile if I don't have tests. Not My Bug is asking, do you use Gitflow? Yes, I try, even if my clients, because I'm a freelancer, even if my clients don't use Gitflow, I try, and as much as I can, kicking and screaming to use Gitflow. I do like Gitflow. Because in my opinion, Gitflow gives you a barrier, puts a nice little gateway between you and the master, what is stable. So I'll do all of my gits all of my commits locally, and then push them to a branch, and then wait until that's ready. And if that's ready, I will put them into a develop branch, and then test that develop branch, and then off we go. And unfortunately, not a lot of people follow that I work with. So I try and do it as much as I possibly can. I don't do it. I don't use Gitflow as I should use Gitflow, because you kind of need to have the buy-in of the team to use it like that. Yes, I'm using Docker Compose for all the things. So this, for instance, is Docker Compose for the user. And I'll quickly show you. This is the course API, Docker Compose. So they're all in separate projects, and they're all linked to the gateway network. This is all dev stuff. So I mean, none of this. I haven't actually got any of this running in any kind of online state, and I've been thinking about how to go about doing that. So obviously, with Docker Compose, you can create environment variables, and you can, you know, .env files and all of this stuff. So Not My Bug is asking a really good question here. I'm a consultant myself. How do you define a freelancer versus a consultant? Well, you could be a freelance consultant. So I am paid to consult. I've actually done a project. Can't talk about it, but I've done a project where I was actually doing the dev side of it, and then I was brought on after the project went live to then consult the new team that came on future changes. So they're very... It's kind of like a Venn diagram where you've got the bit in the middle, the gray area, where there's kind of the consulting and the freelancing going together. Sorry, bear with me just a second. I want to show you something. Right, so every Friday I have a podcast. And I interview people on the podcast. And we were talking about web development consultants. And I interviewed Sam Foote not so long ago. I'll put a link in the chat. And we were talking about web development consultants. So it's the How to Code Well podcast. And that was a really interesting conversation because he is a developer stroke consultant. So we were having that kind of conversation as to what define, and I was asking questions, what do you define as a consultant versus a developer? So yeah, if you want to learn a bit more about that, then do check that out. excuse me. I'm just going through the chat, sorry. I often see using... Okay, right. I often see people using the phrase freelancing to speak to more towards smaller projects. That's what I see in the States. Okay, so... Yeah, definitely. I don't know what it's like in the States, but over here, freelancing is... I mean, I'm working on big projects. I wouldn't call them small. How do you define a big project? So I'm working with clients that are big, as in they are well-known clients in sort of household sort of things. I do smaller projects for like local businesses and stuff like that, definitely. I also do subcontracting, so I will contract out as part of the team, but not, I won't, it's not necessarily, so I'm only working on a small portion of that project, so I'm not actually just developing the whole thing, I'm working on, say, a small bug that they put me on, so it's tricky. I think it can expand and contract, your definition can change depending on the clients. Obviously, when I started out as a freelancer, I was working on very small things because you can't just suddenly go, hi, XYZ, can I become a consultant or a contractor and work on your massive, highly trafficked, extremely busy website. You have to build up a reputation and you have to build up a sort of a portfolio before you can consider working on those kind of things. So yeah, sorry, my music's going a bit squee. Cool, you've been consulting professionally for 10 years, sweet. Yeah, so I've heard people say freelancing and then contracting. So freelancing would be the smaller projects, contracting would be for the bigger projects. Cool. Hey, Marco. Cool. Yeah, it's very weird. You end up wearing lots of different... You end up... See you later, Tyranid. Off to do various stuff. No worries. Happy coding, Tyranid. Thank you for joining. Yeah, so you end up wearing lots of different hats. Like, it's... And I'm more than happy to be called an architect, a consultant, a freelancer. You know, it really depends on the customer, in my opinion. Sure. Yeah, I get that. Definitely. When I speak rates with companies, there's a cost that comes with short-term engagements versus long-term engagements. Also, specialization is key as well. Definitely agree with that. So also, just to sort of add to that, there's also retention as well. So, for example, with the stuff that we do, there, you know, the internet is on all 24/7. So if you need to be put on a call out, you know, as a freelancer, as a consultant, or as a contractor, if something has gone bang in the night and you need to jump on and fix it, then that should be in your contract too, if that is a requirement. Luckily, I've chosen not to do that. But I do know contractors who do. So they're like contractors who, or freelancers, whatever you want to call them, who have a sort of an additional fee for after hours work. So if the database goes bang, if something goes horribly wrong, if someone else on their team does a deployment and then leaves because it's 5 o'clock and it goes horribly, horribly wrong and they're not reachable and you are, and the company is an e-com company losing lots of money because something has gone horribly wrong, then, you know, I know that that is a thing. I try and go for, I guess, long-term engagements, because I don't think my mind can handle lots of little projects. I used to be able to cope with that a lot when I was younger, but now my mind is just like, I want to know a system like the back of my hand. Otherwise, I forget things. The key with staying long-term at a client is building relations with the client. Once you establish yourself, not in good standards with the engineer side, but with the business side, you're gold. Yes. Yeah, definitely. My contracts are typically 3 years or more. Excellent. I have to end them because they can't all... Brilliant. That's really good. Yeah, really, really good. It's nice when you have a piece of work like that, because then you can really embrace it. You know, it's not just something that you're just called upon to, you know, can I just add this little feature to this website? And once you've done it, you're off. Bye bye. It's like, really, you can get into the grains of the project when you're working on it for such a long time. And yes, I totally agree with that statement. It feels like a full-time job when you've got long-term contracts, definitely. Yeah, really agree with that. That's great stuff. It's great to hear that. Not my bug. I'm pleased for you. Yeah. So it's understanding the business needs. So there's sort of a difference with, so understanding the technical requirements is fine. Okay, we've got this specification, this PRD, and we're understanding it from a technical point of view. But then you can go another step and go, well, I'm going to understand this from a business point of view. So what are the business needs? What are the business requirements? What will the business gain from doing it like this? And you can have all sorts of changes to the technical specification based on the business requirements and business needs. So there's been often conversations that I've had, and this is sort of leaning towards more of the consultancy type stuff, where I get a technical specification, and knowing the business background, knowing why they've come up with that technical specification, I can then talk to the business owners and go, do you really need this? Or have you actually thought about this from a long-term perspective? And then now you're moving towards the consultancy side, and you're actually starting to tailor-make the solution based on the business needs, tailor-making the technical requirements. So it's, yeah. And I think that's where I was talking with the Venn diagram. Is it Venn diagram where you got the two circles and the bit in the middle? That's where it kind of, you kind of lean into that a little bit, you know, the consultancy side. Because sometimes I'll just get a brief and it'll be just like, build this. And I'm like, okay, I'll do that. But because I don't know the business requirements, I don't know why they want that built. I don't know the history. I don't know the decisions that they've had to come up with this. But if you're working in a project for 3 years, as Not My Bug is doing, then you get to understand the business requirements. So you get to understand why this technical requirement is a technical requirement. Definitely. I'm on your wavelength, man. Awesome. Yes. Well, hook me up on the old Discord server or on Twitter, and we can have a conversation about this afterwards. If you're up for talking about your experience and you want to go on a podcast, then let me know. Definitely. Cool. I'm going to have to dive off because I am going to have to do some freelance work today. It's 8:48 in the morning, so I need to be on for my morning calls. Oh, no worries. Cool. On Googly Mail. Googly Mail. Awesome. Okay, well, I'll send you a whisper later, yeah? No worries. Oh, it's 12:49 a.m. Oh, you're in Mountain View. Nice. I'm in stone cold Britain right now. It's freezing cold. Anyway, thank you ever so much for watching. Happy coding, everybody. And I will see you again soon. All right? Thank you. Cheers. Bye-bye.